ThinkTech Hawaii. Civil engagement lives here.
Aloha and bienvenido to Hispanic Hawaii. I'm Richard Concepcion. For many years, immigration has played an important role in the development of our nation. But today, immigration reform is at the center stage of our political debate. Immigration reform affects millions of people, and the nation is divided over the right solution of how immigration will impact our nation and the best way to manage. Today's guest is Clare Hanusz. She is an attorney and the founder of Aloha Immigration Firm. She's here to help us to understand what is happening with the immigration reform and the DACA program. Bienvenida to Hispanic Hawaii.
Gracias. Es un placer estar aquí contigo.
Okay, gracias. So, Clare, let's start about, if you can tell me a little bit about yourself and what motivated you to become an attorney.
Sure. So, my father was an attorney, and I saw from an early age how he could use his skills to help other people. And then when I was in university, I traveled to Nicaragua and El Salvador and Guatemala, and I became really taken by the stories of people there and the struggles that they were having, and then met refugees from those countries in the United States. And so I was really inspired by especially the immigration attorneys I met who were playing a really critical role in their lives, and decided that that's what I wanted to do too. So my husband and I moved to Honolulu in 1995, and I went to the Richardson School of Law between 96 and 1999, and really to get my law degree so that I could practice immigration law, and that's what I've been doing ever since.
Well, thank you so much for what you do.
Oh, thank you. It's really an honor to be able to do the work that I do, so thank you.
Well, we have many questions that came from the viewers. Hopefully we'll be able to cover all of it. It's nothing we can, you recommend to do a part two.
Yeah, if we, I know you got many more questions than we have time for, so I'm very happy to come back and do a follow-up.
Okay, perfect. Why do we need an immigration reform?
Right, well basically it's been over 20 years since there's been any kind of overhaul of our immigration laws, and the overhaul that came, the last real big one in 1996, really had some very repressive elements of it that made it very difficult for people to immigrate to the United States. It made it very difficult for people if they had any kind of even minor criminal infraction to be able to stay in the United States. And it's estimated right now that there's at least 12 million undocumented people in the United States. So
Wow. There's
been a push since the Bush administration for what's called comprehensive immigration reform, where that pairs border security along with providing a path for the undocumented people who are living among us in our country today, a path to permanent residency and then citizenship. But, you know, we all know that we saw even under the Obama administration, we weren't able to get there. Under the Trump administration, we think we're really not going to be able to get there. And so right now, advocates and immigrants are really in a defensive mode just trying to keep it together until we get something better.
Oh, wow, that's 20 years.
Yeah, wow, yeah, it's been a long time.
Let's talk about from the economy point of view. Mm-hmm. I have a question right here. Does the immigrant contribute to the economy? Do they pay taxes? Or they don't pay any taxes? Or they just draining or economy?
Right, there's a lot of research done by economists on the pros and cons of immigrant labor in the United States. And again, when we talk about immigrant, we should break down. There are different groups, right? There are legal immigrants, people who are here as permanent resident, and then there are people who are undocumented or unlawful immigrants who are here either they came on a visa, they entered legally in the United States and then they overstayed, or for different reasons, they entered the country illegal and are still here with us. Even those people who entered illegally, the majority of them file tax returns. They can get taxpayer ID numbers. They contribute greatly to the Social Security system, and it's estimated about $15 billion a year undocumented immigrants put into the Social Security system. That's money that they will never, ever get back, and that's actually helping to shore up the Social Security system that people who have lawful status benefit from. So study after study shows that immigrants contribute far more to the economy than they take away.
Wow, that's great. So also, we want to know about how an immigrant applies for the visa and how many different types of visas is available for an immigrant.
Oh, gosh. If you look at the types of visas, it's almost like an alphabet soup, really. No, I mean, really, I mean, there's a B1, a B2. A T, an E1, E2, E3. So lots and lots of different types of visas depending on the reason that the person wants to come to the United States. And what people also need to remember is that, say, for a visitor visa, so for someone from another country, there are many countries, close to 40, where someone can come to the United States for up to 90 days and stay as a visitor under what's called the visa waiver program. So they just have to fill out a quick online application. There's a background check that's part of that, and they don't have to actually physically go into the embassy and apply for a visa. For everyone else, though, to come into the United States, they have to go through a pretty expensive process to actually get a visa stamp in their passport to allow them to come into the United States. So there are people in Hawaii on student visas, there are people here on tourist visas, there are people who are here as immigrant investors who are here on certain visas, people who are here as exchange visitors, lots and lots of visitors. But it's also, for people from many countries, very difficult to even get a visitor visa. I have many clients from Mexico who have legal status here, and their parents or their brother, say, wants to come and visit them, and they apply for visas in Mexico. And those visas are oftentimes not approved, and they're denied because, especially if the person coming to visit doesn't have a whole lot of money and doesn't have a whole lot of financial ties to their home country, so it really does discriminate against people based on their economic
wealth. Oh, how do you know that?
Absolutely. Wow. So those people are often denied because the government feels that they have what's called immigrant intent, meaning that they're going to come and stay and not go back. And it's true that some people do come and not go back, but the majority of people do return.
So what would happen if a person come in on the visa and they decide to stay? Can they still apply for another visa after they came in and stayed illegally?
It really depends on the type of visa. Some types of visas you can extend for years. Some types of visas, such as a visitor visa, you might be able to extend once if you have a really good reason, but usually not more than that. So usually if someone wants to stay in the United States, then they're what's called an intending immigrant. And they have to get lawful status through becoming a legal permanent resident. And that's a very difficult and very limited path, because generally to get to become a lawful permanent resident or have what's called a green card, right? You have to be sponsored by either a very close family member, usually a parent, a spouse, an adult child over 21, or in some cases a brother or sister, or you have to be sponsored by an employer. And usually the employer visas are very, very difficult to get because you have to be super highly skilled, almost have an extraordinary ability in many things. So it's difficult. It's very, very difficult to get a green card and be able to stay in the United States, which is why so many people stay unlawfully.
Well, a lot of people was asking those questions. Thank you so much for answering.
Sure.
That was a very difficult one. So what happened is a person stay illegally and they get notified, the notice of appear to go into an immigration court. What is the next step after they get that notification?
So they should really contact an immigration attorney for advice. So a notice to appear is a document that is given to a person from Immigration and Customs Enforcement that has the charges for why the person is believed to either be in the country illegally or to have somehow violated the terms of their immigration status. The notice to appear is generated by the Department of Homeland Security, and then it's filed with the immigration court. And the immigration court will then send out a notice of hearing telling the person that the person has to come to immigration court for a hearing. And the immigration court in Honolulu is located at the federal building. We have two full-time immigration judges. And immigration court for many people is a very scary, scary, complicated process. Immigration law is a very complicated area of the law. And so the person needs to really try to get legal representation or get some good advice. And then the person really needs to go to court and show up for that hearing. Because if the person doesn't, then the person will be ordered deported in absentia, or that's basically if the judge calls your name and you're not there, then you have then you end up with a deportation order.
Oh, wow.
Yep. Yep, and then you end up being oftentimes a fugitive, and then
that's not good.
At some point, ICE is going to come looking for you.
Wow, that's difficult. So let me ask you, for what countries are the majority of the immigrant come to the United States or to Hawaii?
Yeah, so the United States is a very different kind of population in many ways than Hawaii in terms of demographics. So I looked this up a little bit, and it won't be very surprising. The largest immigrant groups to Hawaii are from the Philippines, first of all, the majority, and then China, Korea, Japan, and then Vietnam. And Vietnam is about, I think, 3%. The Philippines makes up about 40%, so large numbers. In the United States as a whole, the vast majority are from Latin America. Okay, so Mexico and countries further south. And then the second largest group as a whole was Asia and Southeast Asia. And that wasn't really broken down, but I would imagine that China, India are two of the big populations.
Part of the population as well.
Yep.
Yeah, a lot of people really think that it's just Latinos, and they don't realize, they don't get where educated. That is from all over the place, and
absolutely.
They come to the United States for different way of life.
Right, for different reasons, for different opportunities. We do hear immigration from Mexico kind of dominates the national agenda.
That's
when people are talking about immigration. And we do have immigrants from Mexico, documented and undocumented, in Hawaii.
In Hawaii,
absolutely.
Yeah, that's true.
But when you think about the Philippines population, that's the and the people from the Philippines, the vast majority are here lawfully. I mean, every once in a while I'll meet someone who came on a visitor visa and overstayed. But the vast majority of those people who waited in lines for many, many years to be able to come to the United States after a U.S. citizen family member filed a petition for them. And sometimes those waits can be up to 24 years.
24 years?
That's a long time waiting. That is a long time. So if you're filing a petition if you're a U.S. citizen and you're filing a petition for a brother or sister from the Philippines, the wait's about 24 years. For Mexico, it's close to that.
Wow, that's a long time.
It is. Yep.
Wow. That's why we need a reform for the immigration, right?
Well, and there are different kinds of reforms for that, right? I mean, what the Republicans have proposed as reform is completely cutting out that category altogether. So brothers and sisters wouldn't even be able to petition for each other.
Wow, that's hard.
Yep.
Well, let me ask you about legal immigrants who come to Hawaii, but they have a driver license from California. California issued driver license to legal immigrant. Can they stay in Hawaii? Are they able to work in Hawaii? Or for any X reason, they get caught in Hawaii, they can get deported, or they just become an illegal immigrant?
Sure. I mean, if someone, there are many people who are in the United States unlawfully who have legal driver's licenses.
Correct.
Actually, in Hawaii, and this is something that I worked with a group of people on, now we have the ability for people to, regardless of immigration status, get a driver's license.
That's
called
true.
A limited purpose driver's license. It's not valid to get on a plane. It's not what's called real ID compliant, but it is valid for driving and also for getting car insurance. So that's really important for people, and a good opportunity that we have in Hawaii. But just having a driver's license does not give anyone any legal status. So people are still very much at risk when they travel. Even domestically, they can be. There was a situation a few years ago at the Honolulu Airport where there were a number of TSA officers who were got the glorious nickname of the Mexicutioners.
Mexicutioners.
Oh, and if you Google Honolulu,
I will do that. Mexicutioners.
I can't remember if it was the Star Bulletin or the advertiser, but Google Honolulu TSA Mexicutioner, and the story will come up. And what was happening was that people, even if they were flying Neighbor Island, these kind of rogue TSA officers were looking beyond the passport into whether or not the person had a visa or not. And often the person didn't, and then they would call Immigration and Customs Enforcement. So it was clear racial profiling, and they were fired. But it's dangerous for people to travel if they're out of status. Many people do, many people have to, but there's a risk. So just having a driver's license does not give anyone the legal ability to work.
Well, thank you so much for clearing that, because a lot of people misunderstand having a driver's license, they are good to go.
No. And oftentimes, really, even travel is difficult, which is a real problem in Hawaii, because, of course, if you're on the continental U.S., you can get in a car and travel from one state to another, right? Go all
That's
the way
true.
Down to Tierra del Fuego if you want to. But here, if you're on Maui and you're Big Island and you don't have identification that would even be valid to get you on a plane, you're stuck.
Wow, that's true. All right, we're going to take a quick break.
Great.
We're going to return after this important message.
Hi, I'm Dave Stevens, the host of Cyber Underground, every Friday here at 1 p.m. on thinktechhawaii.com. And then every episode is uploaded to the Cyber Underground, that library of shows that you can see of mine on youtube.com. And I hope you'll join us here every Friday. We have some topical discussions about why security matters and what could scare the absolute bejesus out of you if you just try to watch my show all the way through. Hope to see you next time on the Cyber Underground. Stay safe.
This guy looked familiar. He calls himself the Ultra Fan, but that doesn't explain all this.
Why?
He planned this party, planned the snacks, he even planned to coordinate colored shirts, but he didn't plan to have a good time.
Go.
Now you wouldn't do this in your own house, so don't do it in your team's house. Know your limits and plan ahead so that everyone can have a good time.
All right, welcome back to Hispanic Hawaii. I'm Richard Concepcion. I'm here with Clare Hanusz. She is an attorney and the founder of Aloha Immigration Firm, and she's here helping us to understand what is happening with the immigration law and DACA program. And welcome back.
Thank you.
All right, let's continue with the question. I have a question right here, and it's specifically about the benefit that an immigrant can get from the community we have with stamp, we have Social Security, Medicaid. Can an immigrant can apply for those benefits?
Right. So green card holders, or in other words, lawful permanent residents, are eligible for most public assistance programs. Some of the programs have the caveat that the person has had to have had a green card for 5 years prior to applying. Uh-huh. And I would say really look online for the National Immigration Law Center, NILC.org, has really good information about public benefits. Again, NILC.org. And you really have to look kind of benefit by benefit to see whether or not you are eligible. And it is important to remember that people who are undocumented don't qualify for any of these programs, but sometimes someone might be undocumented, but the child might be a U.S. citizen or the child might be a lawful permanent resident.
Oh, that's a good point.
And oftentimes those children are eligible for those benefits, and they should absolutely, you know, take advantage of them. I mean, we all, you know, we live in a country that doesn't provide health care for everyone, so people have to get it however they can.
However they can. That's a good point. What is the advantage and disadvantage of a person, say, well, I'm going to self-deporting and I go back to my country? What is the advantage and disadvantage to return back?
Oh,
legally?
Yeah. God, I think part of what the plan that the government has is to make it so miserable for people who are undocumented to stay in the United States that they just kind of throw in the towel and what's called self-deport. You know, if people didn't have family ties, it would be a lot easier.
That's but true. Oftentimes, you just say, "Oh, I'm done. I leave."
Right. And I've worked with a lot of people who were single males. They were here because they had a very difficult time economically where they were born. They were here to send money back for their families, and I have a lot of respect for that. And it's not financially; it's difficult for them to go home. but home is where their family still is. The issue we have in Hawaii and in many other, all across the United States, is that oftentimes these people who are being put in difficult situations and being, when we talk about self-deportation, oftentimes they're moms or dads, or they have spouses who are U.S. citizens or permanent residents. And depending on the manner how they enter the United States, sometimes they can get green cards through those spouses, but oftentimes they cannot, especially if they entered the country initially illegally. So the question about self-deportation is really, really complicated. If someone's been in the United States for more than a year out of status, so if they entered on a visa and then overstayed that for more than a year, or if they came illegally and then they've been here for more than a year, if they leave the United States, it automatically triggers a 10-year bar to re-entering the U.S.
10 years.
A 10-year penalty to
re-entry. It's a penalty for the entry, for staying legally.
So even if someone files a petition for them, and what happens is the person will then go to, it's a long, expensive process, the person will then go to the embassy or consulate abroad to get their visa, and they'll be told, oh, well, you were in the United States more than a year illegally, and you have a 10-year penalty. So basically, come back in 10 years. Or there's something also called a waiver, where you can ask for special permission to waive that 10-year penalty, but you have to prove extreme hardship to a qualifying family member in the United States. And children are not considered, in that provision, qualifying family members. So if you're just a parent and you don't have a spouse who's a U.S. citizen or permanent resident, if you have five children who are U.S. citizens and they depend on you, you do not qualify to get that waiver. And I don't know if Congress just forgot to include children when they drafted that language, or if they were just being especially cruel. But you see, the situation it sets up is that people don't want to leave, because coming back is so difficult or impossible. And if people re-enter the country illegally, then there's another 10-year bar, and it's a permanent bar. There's no waiver available for that. And the other thing that the government's doing, and doing more and more, is prosecuting people for criminal illegal re-entry, where people, even if they have no other criminal history, but are coming back just because they need to be with their wife and kids and they get caught, people are spending between 3 and 5 years in federal prison. So only for the crime of re-entering the United States.
Yep. Wow, yep. That is so difficult.
So the penalties are really, really harsh. And that's, again, one of the reasons why people just go lower and lower, and deeper and deeper into the shadows, because they know that there are no options for them, which gets back to why do we need immigration reform, because that's no way to live, and that's no way to raise a family.
That's another concern. Nobody want to come forward and provide the information, say, I'm here illegally, because they're so afraid.
Right, because the consequences are really, really harsh.
Yeah. All right, let's talk about DACA.
Yep.
Tell me what DACA is and how this program can affect Hawaii.
Right. So DACA is an acronym for Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals. It was a program that was started under the Obama administration after many, many years of undocumented youth saying, we are here, undocumented, unafraid. We need something for us. We need something for our families. It was a very, very sympathetic group of young people. Many of them were in college. Many of them, all they knew were the United States. Some of them entered the country illegally with their parents. Some of them entered legally, say as their parents came as tourists and they came along a family vacation. For whatever reason, everyone decided to stay. And to qualify for DACA, you had to have come before your 16th birthday. You had to have been under 31 by a certain date in 2012, right. June 15th, 2012. So it's a narrow group of people anyway that qualified. You had to have continuously resided in the United States, so no long absences.
No absences. Right. Can't leave the country.
You could leave for short periods of time, but most people didn't, because they would not have been able to get back in anyway. And you had to have a relatively clean record, and had shown that you had either graduated from high school or were working on your high school degree or your GED. So it was for, you know, people who had been really clean. And about 800,000 people nationwide signed up for this. And what happened was, if the application was approved, and there was a background check and all that, and there was an application fee and a biometrics fee. So if all of that was approved, then you got a two-year work authorization card. So it was, the way I thought of it was kind of a bubble from deportation. It wasn't a path to a green card. It wasn't citizenship at all. It just temporarily protected you from deportation. So if you did get stopped for, like, a red light violation, you would not be put into deportation proceedings if you were DACA protected. It was risky for people to come forward because it was put out by an executive order, and what one president gives as an executive order, another can take away. And that's actually exactly what happened in September under President Trump. He gave yesterday, March 5th, the deadline for Congress. That was today, for Congress to come up with a fix. And Congress, of course, did nothing. Well, some senators tried. It's not that nobody tried, but they were not able to come up with any kind of compromise agreement. And so, thankfully, DACA has been challenged in the courts. And so the courts have said that, two district courts have said that people can continue to renew their applications, but the government doesn't have to accept any new applications. But I just
so this is a catch 22.
It is, and I just met with a military family last week, and they have two children, and her DACA expires next January. So it's too early for her to apply to renew, because you have to apply within, I think it's 120 days, 120 or 150 days. I need to double check, but within a relatively short period before, so you can't. If you're good until next January, you can't put in that application now. And nobody knows what's going to happen in the courts, right? The Supreme Court had said that it's not going to hear it. They're not going to be able to fast track it up to the Supreme Court. So it has to be sorted out in the district courts below. And, you know, for this family with two beautiful young kids, and they're like, what do we do? And I say, I don't know. We wait.
We're still waiting.
If you're praying kind, you pray. You you contact your congressional leaders and senators. And thankfully in Hawaii, all four of our representatives in Congress and the Senate have been very, very pro DACA, very good advocates. But the problem is a lot of the other ones who have not been.
So we have roughly about 800. Dreamers right here in Hawaii,
maybe,
right?
The numbers I've heard are more like 600 or so.
Okay.
Nobody knows for sure, right? And then people apply, and then, you know, sometimes they move away. Sometimes people, like this family that I met that has, where the wife has DACA, she didn't apply for DACA here, but she's in the military and came
and
with her spouse.
So people
move around a bit. It's not a huge number, but for the... If you ever meet anyone who has it, you see the difference that it's made in their life, and you see the incredible stress that this limbo period has had on them, and especially for people with children, for people with spouses, and people with children, because they just don't know.
They don't know what to do.
Yeah, they can't plan, and we take for granted the ability to plan for, you know, what we hope to do next week or next year, and. And they can't. They can't do that at all.
Well, very difficult. So we hope for the best, and we want to say thank you so much for coming to Hispanic Hawaii.
Thank you. It was my pleasure. It was really good to be here today.
I think we might have to do part two.
I'm happy to.
All right. Thank you. All right. We want to say thank you so much for watching Hispanic Hawaii. And don't forget that you can rewatch this program and many other programs on ThinkTech Hawaii. Gracias y hasta luego.